Alhamdulillah, it's a great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has given me and you the ability and tawfiq to participate in this gathering. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this gathering a source of guidance for all of us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this gathering one of the means for our entry into Jannah. As you will know that Alhamdulillah, we are trying to understand the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are trying to understand about our own religion. And Alhamdulillah, so far we have understood three circles. The first circle, which is the most important circle, which you see at the center of a dartboard, that circle is called?
The principles of Islam.
The principles of our religion, which is the most important thing, the asool of our deen, the principle of our religion. In order to bring these principles practically into our life, we go to the next circle. And what is the next circle?
Obligations and prohibitions.
I am tired because I've been reciting Quran throughout the whole day. Believe me, I was reciting Quran throughout the whole day and I'm really, really tired now. MashaAllah, you guys just have iftar and I can't eat proper food in iftar because if I eat more food in iftar, then all you can hear is me burping. That's what I'm doing. Okay. So, kindly, if you can respond, if you can give me some kind of response, so I know that you are with me. So in order to bring these principles into our life, we go to the next circle, and the next circle is major obligations and major
prohibitions.
In Urdu, we call them farais and haram. And then in order to beautify these obligations, we go to the next circle. And the next circle is called?
Recommendations.
Recommendations. So the recommendations are not obligations, right? Do not make recommendations obligations, because if you make recommendations obligation, you will make the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala difficult for people. Now you will turn away, you will turn the people away from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Recommendations are not obligations. Recommendations are there to beautify your obligation. I gave you an example yesterday, if you remember, saying salam is
obligation.
You meet a Muslim brother, saying salam is what?
Obligation.
Obligation. It's wajib. It's first to say salam when you meet your Muslim brother. And it's wajib and it's first, it's an obligation because it fulfills one of the principles of Islam. What is that principle of Islam?
Selflessness.
What are you fulfilling the principle? Which principle are you fulfilling?
Selflessness.
Are you with me so far? Because I started this class because I thought that Alhamdulillah, now you all are ready to learn the deen of Allah. We have already talked about a lot of stuff. We spoke about youngsters, then we spoke about parents, and I can talk about all of these issues again and again and again. But the real thing is, the real point is that we all start understanding the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So saying salam is wajib. Why is it wajib? Because it brings one of the principles of Islam into our life. What is that principle?
Selflessness.
Selflessness. So saying salam is wajib. Do we understand this? But what is the thing that beautifies that salam?
Shaking hand.
So shaking hand is?
Recommendation.
So do we understand these three circles? The most important thing are the principles of Islam. In order to bring principles of Islam into your life, you will follow obligations. And then if you want to become a better Muslim beyond fundamental obligation, then you will start following
recommendations.
So all these extra dua, extra azkar, extra sunnats, extra fasting, fasting on Monday and Thursday, qiyamul layl, tahajjud, all of these things are recommendations. And one another thing that we need to understand before we move to the next circle is that there is no disagreement up until now. In these three circles, there are no disagreement. We are in complete agreement with what the principles are. We are in complete agreement with what the major obligations and the major prohibitions are. And we are in complete agreement with what the recommendations are. You all understand this? Alhamdulillah. Now let's go to the next circle. The next circle is the thing that we call the issues on which Sahaba agreed. In Arabic, you call it Ijma'u Sahaba, the consensus of Sahaba. Do we know what consensus is? The consensus of Sahaba. But in reality, there is no such thing as consensus of Sahaba. In reality, there is no such thing as the full agreement of all the Sahaba. When we say the Ijma'u of Sahaba, the consensus of Sahaba, the agreement of Sahaba, we mean three things. Understand it carefully. We mean three things. Number one, when we say the agreement of Sahaba, it means that some Sahaba, not all, some Sahaba agreed on an event. So let me give you an example. Uzwa Badr, the event of Badr. Do we all know it?
Yeah.
All of us? It's a PhD question, right? Uzwa Badr, the event of Badr. As Muslims, we all should know Ghazwa Badr, right? So the event of Badr is the first confrontation between Muslims and non-Muslims. Did all Sahaba participate in Badr?
No.
Did all Sahaba attend Badr?
No.
How many Sahaba were there?
313.
313 Sahaba were there. And how many Sahaba were there when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam left this dunya?
More than 100,000.
Approximately? 124,000. How many Ahliya Kiram Alayhi Wasallam Allah sent into this dunya?
124,000.
Approximately
124,000.
And when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam left this dunya, there were almost 124,000 companions of Rasulullah. But did they all take part in Badr?
No.
No. At that point, how many Sahaba were there? Only 313. So they will tell you what day Badr took place, how many days it lasted, what were the supplies that we had. They will give you all the details. And these 313 Sahaba, they are in full agreement about the event of
Badr.
This is the first kind of agreement, that some Sahaba agreed on an event. Number two, the second kind of agreement is the scholars among the Sahaba agreed on something. Not all the Sahaba, the scholars among the Sahaba. So for example, you have Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, you have Abdullah bin Mas'ud, you have Abdullah bin Abbas. All of these people were the great scholars among the Sahaba, because there were some other Sahabas who didn't even know one surah of the Quran, because they were new to Islam. They were new Muslims, so they didn't even know a single surah of the Quran. But then there were other Sahaba who were the scholars, who were the most intelligent among the Sahaba, and sometimes they agreed with each other. This agreement is called Ijma'u Fuqaha'u Sahaba, the consensus of the scholars among the Sahaba. So do we understand this? Let's go to the third kind of agreement. The third kind of agreement is when the governors among the Sahaba agreed on something. So for example, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu and his advisors, they agreed on some kind of rule, some kind of policy, some kind of governance. This agreement is also called Ijma'u Umara'u Sahaba, the consensus of the governors among the Sahaba. So there are three kinds of agreement among the Sahaba. Number one, they agreed on an
event.
Number two, scholars of the Sahaba agreed upon something. And number three,
governors.
The governors among the Sahaba, they agreed on something. For example, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he's the head of the state, right? So he needs to decide something. So do you think he will go to every single Sahabi and ask his opinion? There are thousands of Sahaba. So he cannot go to every single Sahaba. So what would he do? He would ask his advisors, some Sahaba, and then they would make a policy. They would reach an agreement, they would make a policy, and they would pass a verdict, and then everyone will follow it. So do we understand this, this fourth circle? Do we understand the fourth circle? The agreement of Sahaba. Now, the problem with that circle, probably you have realized this by now, that whenever I discuss a circle, I also discuss the problem of that circle. Now, the problem with that circle is that a lot of time, Muslim brothers come and they say, Mulana, do you know all Sahaba agreed on this? All Sahaba agreed on this. This is, wait. Where are you getting this from? It's quite obvious, but where is this obvious? In the books, where are those books? You read them, you are a Mulana, you read them and tell us. There is no such thing as the full agreement of Sahaba. You can't just throw these words at people. You can't. Full agreement of Sahaba, you have to be very careful when you say such kind of things. You have to be. And you know, the most funniest thing is that when people come to me and say, this is something that all Sahaba agreed upon, I always ask them this question. Give me the names of 10 Sahaba. Give me the names of 10 Sahaba. You say all Sahaba agreed on it, right? Give me the names of 10 Sahaba. Okay, give me the names of the 10 Sahaba who were guaranteed Jannah in this dunya. Give me the names of those 10 Sahaba. And then they are like, we don't know. We don't know. You know, if you read the books of fiqh, if you read the books of hadith, if you read the books of tafsir, they mention it very, very clearly that there is no such thing as the full agreement of Sahaba. You know, Sahaba, the most smart of the Sahaba, smartest of the Sahaba, the most intelligent of the Sahaba, the scholars among them, sometimes they had difference of opinion. Sometimes they had different opinions. Sometimes they had opposed opinions. Sometimes they have disagreements. And it's okay. It's okay because it's the, which circle?
Fourth circle.
It's the fourth circle. Where in our deen there is no disagreement. There is absolute agreement. Where in our deen?
First three circles.
In the first?
Three circles.
Three circles. And correct me if I'm wrong, we have already spoken about it yesterday. When we give da'wah to someone, when we preach our religion to someone, when we invite someone to our religion, What are the primary things that we share with the people?
First and second circle.
First circle and the?
Second circle.
Second circle. These are the primary things that we share with the people. Once we know that they are within our wings, once we know that they are in our family, once we know that they are in our circles of friends, and once we make sure that they know circle number one and circle number two, then we will work on three. Then we work on circle number three. But circle number four is only for studying and research. That's it. You don't even have to worry about it. So don't take circle number four and tell everyone this is Islam. And your Islam begins from circle number four. No. People start at one and two, then they learn three, and four is something that you don't even have to worry about. It's for those people who study the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who do research in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't have to worry about it. So you all understand this. Are you with me so far? So can I ask you a question now? The class is finished. It's done. So it's my turn to ask you a question so that I know how much you are awake. So the question is, are all Sahaba unanimously in agreement on everything?
No.
No? Okay. Another question. Are all Sahaba unanimously in agreement on the first three circles?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes? So tell people about the first three circles. Don't divide anymore. Don't you divide anymore. Tell people about the first three circles so that you can unite more. You know, the problem with all of us is that we pray Salah, which is in circle number?
One.
Two. Which is in circle number two. We pray Salah. We fast. But at the same time, what do? We divide our ummah as well. We divide our ummah as well. And then we feel that we are doing a very good thing. We are doing a very good thing. We disunite our ummah, because disunity in our ummah, then we justify ourselves Islamically. This is the right path and this is the wrong path. You know, Shaitan, before people used to make mistakes, then they would realize their mistakes and they would ask Allah to forgive them, and Allah would forgive them. Now the problem with all of us is that, including me, I'm no exception. Now the problem with all of us is that we make mistakes and then Shaitan beautifies our mistakes. And then we justify our mistakes Islamically. And then we think we are doing a very good deed by causing disunity in the ummah. Do you have these WhatsApp groups? Do you have these WhatsApp groups?
Yep.
Whenever the month of Ramadan comes, whenever the issue of moon sighting comes, you tell me what happened on the WhatsApp groups. Who is becoming kafir and who is becoming a Muslim? And who is passing a fatwa and where these fatwas are coming from? And then we think we are doing a very good deed. We are doing a very good deed. Let me tell you what is a good deed. One story that I finish, inshallah. Give me just 3 minutes. Just 3 minutes and everything will become clear for you, inshallah. A Sahabi by the name of Wasiba. There is a Sahabi, his name is Wasiba, radiallahu ta'ala. One night he is thinking to himself, what is righteousness and what is sin? What is righteousness and what is sin? And he is confused about it. So he said, okay, tomorrow I will go to Rasulullah and I will ask Rasulullah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is righteousness and what is sin? Next morning he wakes up, Fajr time, he goes to the masjid. And he's thinking that this is the best time and I can get to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because this is Fajr time, so masjid will be empty. As soon as he gets to the masjid is full. Fajr Salah, it's not our time, it's the time of Rasulullah. So masjid is full. He can see Rasulullah, but there is no access to Rasulullah. So what did he start doing? He started pushing people on the side. Excuse me, I have to go to Rasulullah. Excuse me, I have to go to Rasulullah. Now Sahaba are telling him, sit down Wasiba, you are late, sit down, stop pushing us. But he said, I look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he was smiling. Meaning that it was indication, keep coming. It was an indication, keep coming. So he said, I keep pushing people on the side. And I went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I sat down with Rasulullah. And he said, I was so close to Rasulullah that my knees were touching the knees of Rasulullah. It's an expression to tell people that now what I've heard from Rasulullah, It's something that have no shock, that have no doubt, because I was so close to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, I'm here to ask you a question. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled. He said, Wasiba, do you want me to answer your question before you ask me your question? Or should I allow you to ask me your question and then I will answer for you? So Wasiba said, Ya Rasulullah, please answer my question before I ask you my question. Answer my question. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you are here to ask me that what is righteousness and what is sin. And Wasiba radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, by Allah, I am here to ask you the exact same question. Now listen to this carefully. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-birru husnul khulq wal-ithmu ma haka fi sadrik." Al-birru, righteousness, is not to cause disunity in the ummah. Righteousness is what? Al-birru husnul khulq. Righteousness is to have a good character. Wal-ithmu ma haka fi sadrika. And sin is something that pricks in your heart. And you don't want other people to know about it. So according to this hadith of Rasulullah, if you have a live conscience, if your conscience is alive, then you have a means of knowing whether what you are doing is right or wrong. But this is not the part of our discussion. Our part of discussion is when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, righteousness is to have a good character. So if you want to see someone's religiosity, you don't look at his prayers. You don't look at his fasting. The highest level of religiosity, the ultimate level of religiosity, the best expression and illustration of religiosity of someone is what?
Character.
Is character. So you look at his Islam, you look at his rituals, you look at the ibadat that he is doing, and then you see if that ibadat, if that acts of worships, if that rituals are impacting his character or not. If he is a better person after he finishes his salah, alhamdulillah, very good. If he is a better person after he finished the month of Ramadan than he was before the beginning of the month of Ramadan, alhamdulillah, he is a religious guy. What do? We finish our salah, then we tell the person who is standing next to us that your salah is not accepted. Because in the shahud, you were moving your finger up and down, up and down, and up and down. You know, we finish our month of Ramadan, then we say to our brothers that, brother, your Ramadan is not valid because you started the month of Ramadan from Tuesday and we started the month of Ramadan from Monday. That's why your Ramadan is not valid. And because of these differences and fights and conflicts, the youngsters who are sitting here, go and ask them. I receive their questions every single day, especially in Ramadan. They're asking me a lot of questions. They say, Mulana, why do we have to pray to become a good person? We are already a good person. You know what these disagreements and conflicts, because of these disagreements and conflicts, what happened in the youngsters, among the youngsters? Now they are making a distinction between ethical good and religious good. So in our Muslim community, they are brothers, mashallah. Very good to their families, very good to their neighbors. They are honest people, trustworthy people. They park their cars in the right places. They don't park their cars in front of other people, and they don't park their cars on the lawn of East Safal Garden. They don't. So they are good and nice people. Ethically, mashallah, very nice people. But they don't follow religion. And they say, why should we follow religion? We are already nice people. We are already good people. And then on the other hand, you have religious people. Mashallah, they pray salah 5 times a day. They give zakah. They go for hajj. They wear religious garments. They have a long beard. But at the same time, they are not good to their family members. They are always fighting with other Muslim brothers. They are always telling other brothers, we are right and you are wrong. And because of that thing, now there is a distinction. What have we done? We separated the principles of Islam from the obligations of Islam. That's why I'm teaching you religion now, so you understand that Islam is a combination of ethical good and religious good. The principles of Islam are the most important thing. You bring them into your life through religious goods, through obligations and probations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fused them together. We Muslims are separating. So alhamdulillah, do we understand this now? Tell people about the first 3 circles. You don't even have to go to the 4th circle. 5th circle I will talk about tomorrow, inshallah. All of you brothers are requested to come and participate. It will be the last circle, don't worry. I told you I will only take 6 sessions. I have taken 4 sessions. Tomorrow, inshallah, the 5th circle. And inshallah, on the 6th day, we will conclude that topic. And then, hopefully, inshallah, if you give me an opportunity and chance, then I will tell you why religion is so important. Why is it so important? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding.